In our last class of tafsir of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the seer of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we looked at the beginning of light, from that which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was seeking from the different tribes of the mushrikeen, the polytheists. And that which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was seeking after the trip to Ta'if was nusra, victory, man'a, and protection from the different tribes, so that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam could convey the message of his Lord al-Islam. So we said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he went to the different tribes until eventually the efforts and the dividends paid to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the name of who? The Ansar. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after 10 years, as Jabir ibn Abdullah, he mentioned, that makatha Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fi Mecca 10 sinin. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stayed in Mecca 10 years. يَتَّبِعُ النَّاسَ or يَتَتَبَّعُ النَّاسَ فِي مَنَازِلِهِمْ. That he was following the people in their homes, in Suq al-Ukab, in Suq al-Majannah, in Mina. After all these 10 years, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was unable to convince the people of Mecca or any other tribe to give him this protection and to give victory to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. After these 10 years, 6 men, they came from the Ansar, from Medina, and they were the first to give the pledge of allegiance to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the tribe they came from the tribe of Medina is the tribe of what? Al-Khazraj. 6 men came from Khazraj to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And initially, when these 6 men came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they accepted Islam. This was known as the beginning of acceptance of Islam by the Ansar. But during this time, did they give the pledge of allegiance to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? No, they didn't. But they went as 6 back to Medina, to Yathrib, and they doubled in number. And they came back as how many? 12. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he gave victory to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam through this tribe of Medina. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam initially was seeking victory, help, protection from a tribe. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not only give him a tribe, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him how many tribes now? 2 tribes. Because when they came back as 12, 10 was from Khazraj and 2 from what? Aus. And these 2 tribes that came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they were not allies. What were they initially? Enemies. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not only gave him 2 tribes, but gave him 2 warring tribes that came together under the banner of what? The deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which was a sign of the nubuwwah, the prophethood of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because the Khazraj, in leaving the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and going back to Medina, they said, look, between us and our people is a war, a severe war. If you could gather us under one banner, you're upon the haq. So when they came back, the Khazraj, they came with 10 of them and 2 from what? Aus. And it was during this time that the first bay'ah, the pledge of allegiance, was given to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with 12 men. And this bay'ah, this pledge of allegiance, was known as pledge of allegiance of what? Pledge of allegiance of an-nisa, of the women. Because the first pledge of allegiance that was given to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who can remember the ayah? What was the pledge of allegiance? What was the condition? From Surah Mumtahina. What was the pledge of allegiance? يا أيها النبي إذا جاءك المؤمنات يبايعنك على ألا يشركن بالله شيئا. The pledge of allegiance was they will not associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number one. Number two. ولا نعم زنا. They will not fall into زنا, fornication, adultery, theft. They will not kill their children. Not approach falsehood. Now, وَلَا يَعْسِنَّكَ فِي الْمَعْرُوفِ. And they will not disobey you in that which is good. This pledge of allegiance that came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that's known as بَيْعَةٌ nisa, the pledge of allegiance of the women, is the same pledge of allegiance that the woman will later on give to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, what was missing in this pledge of allegiance? If we know the mission and the vision of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is there anything missing from this pledge of allegiance which is not in accordance to the vision or the mission of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Is there anything missing in this pledge of allegiance? Barakallahu feek, no protection. Because he used to say to them, man yu'wini, man yamna'uni, who's going to give me refuge, who's going to do what? Protection. And this is what Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, will always ask them, how is your number and how are you when it comes to warfare? So missing in this was protection, the first bay'ah. So they gave the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam this bay'ah, this pledge of allegiance. This is what we looked at last week. And this bay'ah was known as bay'ah, the pledge of allegiance, what? Al-Aqabah Al-Ula, the first pledge of allegiance of Al-Aqabah. So this is what we looked at last week. And we said this week, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to look at the durus wal-ibar, lessons and examples we could take from this pledge of allegiance who apply to our life according to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're going to look at lessons from this pledge of allegiance. Now this pledge of allegiance, we said in the very beginning of this lesson, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he stayed for how many years in Mecca according to the people? 10 years. And then he started after that to go to the qaba'il, to the different tribes. To the different tribes. And success came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam through these 6 men, they came from Khazraj. And how successful was it? It was immediate success, that they accepted that which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said immediately. Unlike the people of who? The people of Mecca. This is the first lesson and the first example we should take in da'wah. The speed at which they accepted that which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam they accepted that which someone was saying to them. The speed at which they accepted it. This is a lesson. Now we have to ask ourselves, why did they accept it so quickly? Why did they embrace the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so quickly? The first lesson we could get from this is that certain people, certain tribes, certain nations or nationalities, certain races, by the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them naturally, they have in them attributes that makes the truth easier for them to accept. Certain attributes. And what are those attributes? Those attributes are the attributes of lean, softness, warqa, and gentleness. So the Ansar, due to the attribute of gentleness and softness, the truth was easier for them to accept. And this is a lesson for us in da'wah. That gentleness, when you find it in the people, and softness and good manners to accept the truth is easier for them. So when you're giving da'wah and you recognize in the people softness and gentleness, it's an opportune moment or to take opportunity of that to call them to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here in Qatar, for example, it's a multicultural society, multinational society. And you will find in Qatar, amongst the different nationalities, there are certain nationalities that they are known for their softness. They are known for their gentleness. And wherever I've been in the world, whether it was in Saudi, whether it's in Qatar, anywhere I go around the world, this particular nationality is that they all have the same behavior. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. How could I help you, sir? How could I help you, ma'am? And we know what we're speaking about. So it is no wonder. When I was in Jeddah, the brothers used to go to the fish market and they will come into the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, men and women, afwaja. It is no wonder when you go to Al-Fana, you find this nationality of people entering Islam maybe more than any other nationality. It is no wonder that I've been to a few janazah here in Qatar, and yet the numbers have not been that great, even though the expats are here in great number. But when it came to the janazah of one of them, one of their du'at, rahimahullah azza wa jal, the masjid was packed. I've never seen a janazah like that. So due to a softness of our people and the gentleness of our people, because when you're soft, when you're gentle, it means you lack arrogance and you lack what? Pride. Because arrogance and pride is a preventative method from the truth. And that's why Shaytan, even though he knew Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, his position, he knew that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ordering him with is the haq. Why did he refuse? Abba. He refused. Why? Wastakbara. And he became proud and haughty. The Ansar, therefore, did not also have a rebellious nature. People that are soft and gentle, they don't have a rebellious nature. And rebellion in Arabic is called juhud. So those who do not accept the message of Islam is one of two things. Either arrogance or what? Being rebellious. So if you look at Fir'aun and his army, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in describing their level of awareness of that which Musa came with, he gave them the highest level of ma'rifah. And when it comes to awareness or knowledge, what's the highest level of knowledge or awareness? Yaqeen, certainty. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَجَحَدُوا بِهَا وَاسْتَيْقَنَتْهَا أَنفُسَهُمْ. They fought against the message of Musa. وَاسْتَيْقَنَتْهَا أَنفُسَهُمْ But yet in their hearts they had what? Yaqeen, certainty Musa came with the truth. But they refused it because of what? Juhud, rebellion. Abu Jahl, Abu Lahab. Why did they refuse the message of Prophet ﷺ? Juhudan, out of what? Being rebellious. Abu Jahl used to say, Wallahi, I swear by Allah, أعتقد أن محمد صادق. I swear Muhammad is truthful. That's Abu Jahl. To a point that Abu Talib, he made a poetry about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Abu Talib died as well, as a mushrik, as a polytheist. He made a poetry that Ibn Kathir rahimahullah ta'ala said, this poetry made, it should have been hung inside the Kaaba. Because any good poetry in those days, they would hang it inside the Kaaba. He made this poetry after the prophethood of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, وَلَقَدْ عَلِمُوا أَنَّ ابْنَنَا لَيْسَ مُكَذِّبٌ لَدَيْنَا That they know, the whole of the Quraysh. That our son, because they knew him, they named As-Sadiq, the truthful, like Amin. They know our son is not a liar. وَلَا يُعْنَى And even from his early childhood to now, لَا يُعْنَى بِقَوْلِ الْأَبَاطِلِ He's not known that's known to be concerned with falsehood. But yet they refuse. They refuse the message of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the Ansar had this attribute. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith, that قَدْ آتَاكُمْ أَهْلُ الْيَمَنِ That the people of Yemen have come. So every nationality have an attribute, have a trait. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, قَدْ آتَاكُمْ أَهْلُ الْيَمَنِ The people of Yemen have come to you. وَهُمْ أَرْقَى أَفْئِدَةً وَأَلْيَنُ قُلُوبًا And the people of Yemen, they're the most gentle when it comes to heart and the softest of hearts. And the people, Al-Aws wal-Khazraj, just like many of the Arabs, their root goes back to where? To Yemen. They were originally from Yemen. So that attribute was in them of softness and gentleness. So this is the first thing we notice, that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam called them to Islam, they accepted it immediately due to a lack of what? Pride, arrogance, and they had a soft and a gentle heart. The second thing, and this should serve as a revision to us inshallah ta'ala, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam called them to Al-Islam, they accepted this call easily. Why, Ya Mus'ab? Why did they accept this call easily? What was the first statement they said after he called them to Islam? Ya Mus'ab. You missed last week's question. I'm not going to let you off this week. What was the first thing? Yeah, Salman. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam starts finish explaining Islam to them, what did they say one to each other? The six. Huh? La. What's the first thing they said? Yeah, Aba Matillah. The first thing they said, Na'am. Barakallahu feek. The first thing they said, they looked one to each other. And they said, Ya qawm ta'allamu wallahi innahu lan nabi. They said, O people, we swear by Allah, this is the Prophet. Alladhi tawa'adakum bihi al-yahud. The one who the Jews have been threatening you with. So, what made them accept Islam faster than Ahlul Makkah was the fact they had knowledge of previous heavenly revealed scriptures. They had knowledge about messengers. Even though it was little, about prophethood and that messengerhood, they had this knowledge. And why did they have this knowledge? Because their neighbors were the who? Ahlul Kitab, the people of the book from the Jews. So this made it easier. Because the people of Mecca, they had no previous knowledge concerning this. Which is another reason. When you're calling people that have a basis in religion, it's easier than somebody who doesn't have a basis at all. So due to the fact of that they were neighbors with the Jews, they had knowledge of the book, previous knowledge of the book. So it made it easier for them to accept the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the Jews, as we mentioned last week, they threatened the people of Medina with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That the Jews, they used to say to Aws wal Khazraj in Jahiliyyah, that inna nabiyyana qad adalla zamanuhu. نَقْتُلُكُمْ بِهِ قَتْلَ عَادْ وَإِرْمُ That our Prophet, his time has come. There's a Prophet that is going to come. And when this Prophet comes, we're going to destroy you as or kill you like the people of عَادْ وَإِرْمُ were killed. And who are the people of إِرْمُ? The people of Ad, Irama Dhat al-Imad. The people of the city of Irm, the Jews used to threaten the Mushrikeen. Even though the Jews were fewer in numbers than Aus and Khazraj. But they knew that this Prophet coming is not about numbers anymore. They knew, كَمْ مِنْ فِئَةٍ قَلِيلَةٍ. How many times would a small group defeat a what? A large group, بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. They knew this Prophet that is coming, it doesn't matter what number, how many you are in numbers. That, وَمَا رَمَيْتَ إِذْ رَمَيْتَ. That many throws, it's not him that's throwing. وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ رَمَى. But Allah Ta'ala is the one that's throwing. They knew this. They knew that this Prophet will bring victory. Which is one of the reasons Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose Jaziratul Arab, the Arabian Peninsula, as a miracle to show that it's the message of Allah. Why? When we look at the numbers of the Arabs in their war, how many were they? How many they consider to be a lot? How many? 1,000. To them, 1,000 men is too much. You could never be defeated. So their wars were always small in number, but yet they went to conquer different countries and Islam spread. To show that this message is the message of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and it's come with the truth. So the Jews used to threaten them with this. So far, we looked at the Ansar, how easy it was for them to accept Islam. Number one, due to their nature. Jayid. Number two, due to what? The fact they had knowledge of what? Previous knowledge of the people of the book. Due to the Yahud that used to threaten them. Also, when we look at their soft nature, there are people that naturally are soft in nature, but circumstances and situation can make it even softer or humble you. So, and there's some people, they're not soft in nature, but circumstances forces them to be humble. So when we look at the Ansar, or the people of Medina, Aus wal Khazraj, Ya Aba Abdillah, what situation were they in and what was their circumstances when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam called them to Islam? Barakallahu fi. Very good. They were at war with each other for generations and they were tired of this war. So certain circumstances, certain situations could humble you. Because one of the wars, one of the days of the wars was Yawm al-Ba'ath, the day of Ba'ath, where they lost their greatest leaders from both tribes and the best of their communities. That these people they lost in this war, they were on the same status as the chieftains of Quraysh, the chieftain people of Ta'if. They lost a lot during this war. So this war actually did what to them? It humbled them. And this is the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah ta'ala says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا فِي قَرْيَةٍ مِّن نَبِيٍّ إِلَّا أَخَذْنَا أَهْلَهَا بِالْبَأْسَاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَضَّرَّعُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we never send a prophet to any city except before we send the prophet, we seize the people bil ba'sa'i with poverty, wal darra'i and hardship, la'allahum, so they may do what? So they become humble. Subhanallah. So that thing, that war, it humbled them because they lost so much. And this is an example to us in da'wah. When you see conflict, we as Muslims, when we see conflict, our stance, our position should be what? Conflict resolution. To bring the people to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We should not take sides. Conflict resolution. And in modern times, contemporary time, wherever there's been a conflict, and the Muslims took advantage of it for da'wah, people came to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, afwaja. In multifold. In recent times, there was the war or the massacre. Or the genocide in Rwanda, where people, two tribes of people, just like the Aus and Khazraj were killing each other. These were Tutsis and the Hutsis. They were killing each other. And the manner in which they were killing each other was barbaric. It wasn't bullets, they were hacking each other to death with machetes. They were killing each other with machetes. And when this massacre was taking place, from the Muslims, they also belonged to two tribes. Both tribes, but due to the jahiliyyah of tribalism, those Hutsis and Tutsis, they couldn't find refuge anywhere. They were even slaughtering each other, even in the churches. Did you know the only place they could find refuge was in the mosque? Whether they were Muslims or non-Muslims, whoever tribe they belonged to, they found refuge in the mosque, because we don't practice that jahiliyyah. And it made a lot of them come into the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whenever you find a conflict between two people, it's an opportunity of da'wah. That the same way the Prophet ﷺ brought together these two tribes under the banner of Islam, you could always bring people under the banner of Islam and resolve their conflict. So there's no better system, there's no better way when it comes to real conflict resolution than the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Prophet. And that's why you find amongst Muslims, non-Muslims, they have many ceasefires. In one day, one month, one year, that ceasefire, most time is what? It's broken and violated. Because not upon the Book of Allah or the Sunnah of the Prophet. So the Prophet, he took advantage of this as well. The fact they've been humbled. And that humbleness, they lost their leaders. And that's another thing you have to take note of. When there's a war, when there's a conflict, people lose their top leaders. The fact they lost their top leaders was a disadvantage for them, but advantage for who? For Islam. Why? Because the leaders are usually the what? The elders. And elders are setting their what? In their ways. If you had approached the elders, just like the elders of Mecca, the elders of Ta'if, what they have done? They would have rejected it. وَجَدْنَا أَبَاءَنَا We find our fathers upon this. We're not going to leave this. But the people the Prophet ﷺ was approaching, most of them were what? Shabab. Youth. Were accepting of anything new which was the truth. Unlike older people were set in their ways. So also from the lesson of da'wah, try as much as possible. The youth, they're very, very important. So the fact they lost their leaders, it didn't serve as a stumbling block. With the other tribes, their elders were always the what? The stumbling block. So when you look at the elders, they lost Yawm al-Ba'ath, the day of Ba'ath. They lost great people in that war. One of those people was the first people the Prophet ﷺ connected with before the six. And what was his name? Suwayd ibn Samit. He died in that war. Another person that died in that war was who? Iyas ibn Mu'adh. Iyas ibn Mu'adh, when he spoke and said the Prophet ﷺ, when he first met him, he's come with the truth. Who prevented him from speaking? One of the elders. One of the elders prevented him from speaking. So the fact the elders were not amongst them, this removed that stumbling block. So Bay'ah al-Aqabah al-Ula, it took place. And these are the lessons we learn from it. Another lesson we learn from it, that although the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam only had in his hand was what? 12 men given in Bay'ah. But he put all his effort, all his energy into making sure that I've got these 12 Bay'ah, I'm going to make sure that foundation from which Islam will spring from is a solid foundation. So what did he do? He sent Mus'ab ibn Umayr to lay the groundwork for da'wah, to lay the groundwork for hijrah. And when Mus'ab ibn Umayr went there, two things also happened. The Islam of Usayd ibn Hudayr. And what else? Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, which is a greater victory. Because through the Islam of these two, many people from the people of Medina, Yathrib, they accepted the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Many people, just two people that they recognize these are the chief of their people. They accept Islam, those under them will accept the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam set a strong foundation. And it's important to set a strong foundation from the beginning. That although the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he knew that's what he had right now. He didn't look or become concerned at what he doesn't have. Because Yathrib, how are we going to launch and spread Islam to the whole world just from Medina? But one lesson you learn from this is, if you concentrate upon your circle of influence, eventually will affect your circle of concern. Don't always look at what your circle of concern. Sometimes you look at things you cannot help, things you can't do anything about, but you forget about what you could do something about. Because the stronger your circle of influence becomes, it starts to affect what? Your circle of concern. So that influence was only Medina. But from Medina, it grew and it became what it has become today. That you will see, as we saw later on the seerah, that the moment they concentrate on what they could do something about, and when they build the khandaq, the trench, that was a terrifying moment. The moment where the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, Allah ta'ala said, "Qulub balagat al-hanaja." It was such a fearful situation, their hearts reached their throat. They were under a blockade. They were a bit under a siege. For the first time in the history of the Arabs, they all came together, the people of the book and the mushrikeen. And they laid a siege upon them. But during that siege, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in breaking the rocks, for building the trench, you'll say, we've conquered such and such a place. You're under a siege in Medina, and you're saying you've conquered the Romans, you've conquered the Persians. But from then, all it concentrated was the rock. Concentrate on the rock. Verily, we're going to conquer these places. Because it concentrated on the circle of what? Influence. And that's why the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, when later on they remember these things the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to say, he used to bring tears to their eyes. One of them was Suraqa. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was running or fleeing from Mecca, Hijra to Medina. And Suraqa is a clever person. He was like a bounty hunter. They sent him upon the trail of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he found the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet said to him, if you leave us alone, you don't tell us where they are, I promise you, I guarantee you, this is a person fleeing from Mecca to Medina, and he's guaranteeing somebody something, that I guarantee you the bamboos or the gold of who? Kisra. One of the greatest empires, the greatest kings. You're fleeing right now from Mecca to Medina to another tribe, and you guarantee me this? Eventually they did conquer them. And you know who had that bangle? Suraqa. And he cried that, subhanAllah, he promised me this and I got this. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam always concentrated and said, lesson for your life, your circle of influence. So these are the lessons we learned. So Mus'ab ibn Umayr concentrated on what he had. After the 13th year of Hijrah, he returned to Mecca to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when he came back, he gave the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam a picture, the image of what's happening in Medina. So Mus'ab ibn Umayr, he came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he said to the Prophet sallam, that verily when it comes to Aus wal Khazraj, that many of them have accepted Islam. But more than anything now, he said, wa innal qawma jahizun li bay'a jadida. Forget the previous pledge of allegiance. They want to do a new pledge of allegiance. And that pledge of allegiance now is going to be what? Al-man'a wal-harb. Pledge of allegiance of protection and war. He said, innahum ja'izun qadira ala himayati rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa man'atuh. That they're ready to defend the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and protect him, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Based on the statement of Mus'ab ibn Umayr, a second meeting was arranged in the 13th year after Prophet ordered the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam during the season of Hajj. So now the Ansar came, the delegates came from the Ansar. Now these are the delegates only, not the amount of people that accepted what? Al-Islam. And the people that came for Hajj in the 13th year after the Prophet ordered the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was bid'u wa sab'una nafsan min al-Muslimin. More than 73 people came. From where? From Yathrib. Imagine that number. 73, they came from Hajj to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to meet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam secretly and to give the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam the new pledge of allegiance. And this was during Ayyam al-Tashriq, the days of Tashriq. And they met at a place called Al-Aqabah, the same place they met the first time. So such a place, or this what may take place, Bay'a al-Aqaba al-Thaniya, the second pledge of allegiance. Jabir ibn Abdullah radiallahu anhu relates the reason behind this bay'ah. He said, we said to each other, the Ansar, حَتَّى مَتَى نَتْرُكْ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يُتْرَدُ فِي جِبَالِ مَكَّةِ وَيُخَافُ. He said, we said to ourselves, until when are we going to leave the Prophet being expelled to the mountains of Mecca and he's being made to fear? Until when are we going to do this? So he said, we left 70 of us, men. We went to the Prophet ﷺ during the Mawsim. And we promised the Prophet ﷺ, we're going to meet him in Al-Aqabah. We're going to meet him in Al-Aqabah. And he said, they came to the Prophet ﷺ and we said to him that we've come to give you bay'ah. The Prophet ﷺ said to them, أَتُبَايِعُونِي عَلَى السَّمْعِ وَطَاعَةً. So this is the new bay'ah now. That are you going to give me a pledge of allegiance upon listening and obeying fi nashati wal kasal, at times of energy, strength, and times of laziness. Wal nafaqa fil usri wal yusri. Do you also give me your pledge of allegiance that you will spend and you will give in times of difficulty, times of ease? Wa ala al amr bi ma'roof wa nahi an munkar. They also give me this pledge of allegiance with the condition of enjoining the good and forbidding the evil. وَأَن تَقُولُ فِي اللَّهِ And you say the truth for the sake of Allah. وَلَا تَخَافُونَ لَوْمَةَ لَائِمٍ. You not fear the blame or the blame. And most importantly, وَأَن تَنْصُرُونِي فَتَمْنَعُونِي. And that you're going to aid me, you're going to protect me. And if anybody steps to me to harm me, تَمْنَعُونَ مِنْهُ. That you protect me, مِمَّا تَمْنَعُونَ مِنْهُ أَنفُسَكُمْ. The same way you protect yourselves, وَأَزْوَاجَكُمْ, and your wives, وَأَبْنَاءَكُمْ, and your children. And if you do that, فَلَكُمُ الْجَنَّةِ. If you do this, you have Jannah. At this point, as heavy as this bay'ah was, that it meant war, it was said, قُمْنَا إِلَيْهِ. All of the Ansar, they stood to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَأَخَذَ بِيَدِهِ. He said, they all stood to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and As'ad ibn Zurara. Who's As'ad ibn Zurara? Was the first of the original six. He took the hand of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he was the youngest of them at that time. And he knew what this bay'ah meant. So he took the hand of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he said, Ruwaydan ya ahla Yathrib. Because they all wanted to give bay'ah. So he said to him, no, hold on, take it easy, people of Yathrib, people of Medina, you have to know what you're committing to. So he said to them, that you've taken this journey, you know he's the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But you should also know, وَأَنَّ إِخْرَاجُهُ إِخْرَاجَهُ لِيَوْمُ مُفَارَقَةُ الْعَرَبِ. That today he's come out as a messenger, we're giving him a bay'ah, but this bay'ah means مُفَارَقَةُ الْعَرَبِ. Bid farewell to all the Arabs. This is the end of relation between you and them. So you should understand that. مُفَارَقَةُ الْعَرَبِ. Bid farewell to the Arabs, your brethren from the Arabs. And not only bid farewell to them, they're not going to leave you alone. He said, this bay'ah you're giving right now, what is it going to lead to? He said, قَتْلُ خِيَارِكُمْ. It's going to lead to the death of the best of you. And this is what happened. The best of them were killed later on. He said, this bay'ah, don't just say, okay, you're going to obey him or protect him. No. Bid farewell to Arabs, but at the same time, the best of you is going to be killed. And he went on to say to them, and you're going to taste and you're going to bite upon the sword of the Arabs due to this bay'ah. He said, فَإِمَّا أَنْتُمْ قَوْمٌ تَصْبِرُونَ عَلَى ذَلِكَ. Either you be patient upon that, وَأَجُكُمْ عَلَى اللَّهِ, your reward is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَإِمَّا أَنْتُمْ قَوْمٌ تَخَافُونَ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ. Or you are people that fear for yourself, cowardism. Yes? فَبَيِّنُوا ذَلِكَ. Let it be known now. And may Allah excuse you. But if you're not ready to go this far, let it be known now. When he finished speaking, As'ad ibn Zurara, what did the Ansar say to him? They said to Umti Anna, leave us alone. We already knew this before we even gave the bay'ah, that we're ready to lose our lives and our family for this. They said, leave us, you don't even need to tell us this. And they gave the bay'ah, the pledge of allegiance to the Prophet, and they said, لَا نَدْعُ هَذِهِ الْبَيْعَ أَبَدًا. We will never leave this bay'ah. وَلَا نَسْلِيهَا. I will never break this bay'ah to the Prophet ﷺ. أَبَدًا. And at that moment, they all stood and went to the Prophet ﷺ and gave him the bay'ah. After this, the bay'ah to the Prophet ﷺ, this bay'ah, according to Ubadah ibn Samit, was known as the bay'ah, bay'atul harb, the pledge of allegiance of war. One of the other Sahabi, radiallahu anhu, in the riwayah, Ka'b ibn Malik, he went into more details concerning this bay'ah. He said, concerning this bay'ah, that kharajna, we went during the time of Hajj with our people. And some of the people that went with were what? Mushrikeen, from people of Medina. He said, we went with the Mushrikeen for Hajj. And we prayed, and after praying, we promised the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we're going to see him in Al-Aqabah during the days of Tashriq. He said, we used to hide and keep it secret, our affairs from the Mushrikeen of Medina that we came with for Hajj. So he said, فَنِمْنَا تِلْكَ اللَّيْلَةِ. We slept that night. The night we're going to give the pledge of allegiance to the Prophet ﷺ. He said, we slept تِلْكَ اللَّيْلَةِ, that night. And after that, after sleeping, he said, when a third of the night had passed, we woke each other up. So the people did not suspect, they didn't know they would get up. So they slept with the Mushrikeen they came with from Medina. During the middle of the night, they woke each other up. He said, when we woke each other up, نتسلسل, we left in secrecy like a covert operation, quietly, and went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hiding. And then when we met in Shi'ab al-Aqabah, وَنَحْنُ ثَلَاثُ وَسَبْعُونَ رَجُلًا And we were 73 men, or 73 people. He said, وَمَعَنَا إِمْرَأَتَانْ مِنْ نِسَائِنَا We had two women with us. And what these two women is of no surprise. Nusayba bint Ka'b. And also Asma bint Amr. And all of us should know Nusayba. Nusayba bint Ka'b. She was known as Khatibatul Nisa, the spokeswoman, for the women. Khatiba of Al-Nisa, Nusayba. Young man, who knows Nusayba here from the young, from the children, Nusayba? These are from the heroes of Islam. The ayah in the Quran, Surah Al-Ahzab, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Inna al-Muslimina wal-Muslimat wal-Mu'mini wal-Mu'minat, that shows equality between men and women in reward. They said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent this down because of Nusayba, because of her status. Nusayba bint Ka'b, during the battle of Uhud, when the mushrikeen, they attacked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when the archers had left their places, and they saw it as an opportune moment to assassinate the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what was happening during that time? The Sahaba radiallahu anhum, if they threw a spear to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they'd fly in the way of the spear and they'll die. So there's no better bodyguard, there's no better bullet catches than the Sahaba. But Nusayba and the women, they were not allowed to go for jihad, she was just wanted to treat the injured. Yes, but she carried with her a bow and an arrow. And any time they come towards the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she was the one shooting the bows and the arrow and defending the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When her bows and arrows ran out, she went into the middle of the battle. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Nusayba, whether I look to my left, whether I look to my right, all around was Nusayba defending me with a sword, and she took a shield. In fact, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ordered one of the Sahaba to give her his shield, for she's the one fighting. Khatibatun Nisa, she was one of those three women, and she was a spokeswoman for the women. And the reason she was a spokeswoman for the women, she always had this braveness to speak on behalf of the women. So once she went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and she said, you men, you get to go for Salatul Jama'ah, a congregation of prayer, Jihad, Janaz, and so on and so forth. Do we women share a reward with you in that by staying at home and looking after your children? Do we share the reward? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam turned to the Sahaba and said, Subhanallah, do you know, did you ever think a good question like this could be asked? Look at the question of this woman. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, our jihad, our salat jama'ah, our janazah, our enjoying the good of the evil, the fact you stay at home, you look after your children, يَعْدِلُ ذَلِكَ كُلِّ You don't share with us in the reward, what you do is equates to all of that. It's equal to all of that. So Nusayba bint Ka'b wa Asma bint Amr were the two. So he said, we gathered in Al-Aqabah. نَنْتَظِرُ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ We're waiting for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And whilst they're waiting for the Prophet ﷺ, who turned up? Al-Abbas. Was Al-Abbas the uncle of the Prophet ﷺ? Was he a Muslim? He wasn't a Muslim, but he turned up. So Al-Abbas, he turned up with the Prophet ﷺ. Why did he turn up? Because he's his nephew. So they had that loyalty. Even though he was a mushrik, he turned up with his nephew. So he turned up with his nephew, the Prophet ﷺ, and he said to the Ansar, to the people of Medina, that verily Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is under the protection of his people, Banu Hashim, will protect him always. But he's decided now to go to Medina. I want you to guarantee you're going to look after my nephew. Even though he's a mushrik, he wanted that promise from them, that Abbas radiallahu ta'ala an, he did not come illa liyata'akkad, except to make sure the Ansar will look after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that's why I mentioned last week class, that strategically, where you can go, where I can go, is different for different people. That according to your tribe, your nationality, you may be more successful in da'wah in some parts of Africa than going to Saudi Arabia or Yemen because of what? The tribal allegiance, nationality, where you have strength. So the Prophet took advantage of this. After this, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he had this guarantee from them, he said to them, the same thing, that I want you to give me the pledge of allegiance, that you protect me from that which you protect your women and your children. He said, Bara ibn Ma'rur, he took the hand of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَالَّذِي بَعَثَكَ بِالْحَقِّ لَنَمْنَعَنَّكَ بِمَا نَمْنَعَ مِنْهُ أُزْرُنَا أُزْرُنَا. That we're going to protect you by that which will protect everything in our capability of our power. And he said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that wallahi, by Allah, فَنَحْنُ وَاللَّهِ أَهْلُ الْحَرْبِ وَأَهْلُ الْحَلْقَ. That by Allah, we're people of war and we're people of weaponry. We're going to defend you, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. After giving this pledge of allegiance to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he made this statement, another of the Sahabi, Abu Haytham, he asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that ya Rasulullah, إِنَّ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَ الرِّجَالِ حِبَالًا وَإِنَّا قَاطَعُوهَا يَعْنِي الْيَهُودِ. Between us and the people is a connection relationship. And we broke that relationship. And what did they have a connection with? The Jews. He said, by the mere fact we accepted you, we've broken that relationship. So he said, فَهَلْ, what if Allah Ta'ala gives you victory and you go back to your people? Are you going to abandon us? Because now we're broken off from the Yahud and you're going to go back to your people. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَتَبَسَّمَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he smiled. And he said to them, بَلِ الدَّمْ الدَّمْ. It's one blood now. My blood is your blood. Your blood is my blood. وَالْهَدَمْ الْهَدَمْ. Your destruction, your death is my death. And my death is your death. Forget all that you read and you see. One for all. And all for one. SubhanAllah. Blood for blood. This death for death. أَنَا مِنْكُمْ. I am from you. وَأَنْتُمْ. And you are مِنِّي. You're from me. We're one now. I'll never abandon you. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, أُحَارِبُ مَنْ حَارَبْتُمْ. I'll go to war with anyone who goes to war with you. And I'll have peace with anyone who has peace with you. So after this, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said this to them. He told them to select from them 12 نَقِيبًا. 12 of them to be a leader over them. 12 of them. 9 from Khazraj and 3 from Al-Aws. After that, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ordered them to leave immediately. Because Shaytan had heard about this bay'ah. And Shaytan informed the Quraysh. So when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam informed them to leave, Abbas ibn Ubadah, he turned to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because at this moment now, they've given the bay'ah. So he said, Wallahi ladhi ba'athaka bilhaq. He said, okay, tell us to leave now. The Shaytan has heard, the Quraysh have known about it. He said, I swear by the one who sent you with the truth. That if you want, in shi'ta, la namilanna ala ahli mina ghadan bi asyafina. If you want, out of fear, you tell us to leave now. If you want, and if you so wish, tomorrow, because everybody's gathered in Mina, he said, we'll rain down upon the people of Mina with our swords, if you want this. And look how many they were in number. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَمْ نُؤْمَرْ بِذَلِكَ. We've not been ordered to do this, but go back to your dwellings. And they left the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they went back to their dwellings. And then the mushrikeen, they went to the people of Yathrib, the people of Medina. Did you give bay'ah? The mushrikeen knew nothing about it. They swore by Allah, said, Wallahi, we didn't give a bay'ah. We're never going to bay'ah. There's going to be a hijrah, we're going to protect it. But the Muslim knew. And those that knew, for amongst them, kept it a secret, and they fled. They went back to Medina. Next week, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to look at the benefits or the lesson from Bay'ah Al-Aqabah Al-Thaniya. The lessons we learn from the second Bay'ah. There's a lot of important durus, lots of important events. We're not going into details, inshallah ta'ala, we'll do so next week. And also the week after that, rather than going to Hijrah, we're going to finish all the ayahs of Mecca for another 2 weeks. And then we'll go to the Hijrah to Medina. And the Hijrah, subhanAllah, when it comes to takhteet, strategic planning, it's a lesson. Anyone wants to know about strategic planning, leadership, managing a project, conflict resolution, motivational, because sometimes it's all these motivational speeches. You want to know about motivation, that hijrah, amazing. And it's amazing that the hijrah took place after Isra and Mi'raj. Which is further, which is more difficult? Going to the seven heavens or going to Medina? Seven heavens. But yet, the details were so put in there. For a lesson for who? For us. In how to plan. Because Allah Ta'ala said, we're going to take it from Mecca to Medina in the blink of an eye. In the blink of an eye. But that hijrah, subhanAllah, lots of lessons in there. Whether it's how Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, whether it's the Hijra of the women, how they did it, whether it's how they planned, what they did when they reached Medina, subhanAllah, amazing, amazing. So inshallah ta'ala, next week we'll look at the lesson from Bay'ah Al-Aqabah Thaniya. We'll go back for another 2 weeks to the ayahs of Mecca. We'll try and finish them in 2-3 weeks and we'll go to the Hijra. And once we go to Hijra, we're going to look at the ayah of Al-Madaniya, Medina. Any questions, inshallah?